Boardroom Bound, Episode 53, Leveraging Strategic Thinking in the Boardroom with Rich Horwath.
The ability to listen and not come in thinking I know all of the answers, but rather I'm going to ask great questions in order to generate conversation and insights from the rest of the group. And then I'm going to take those in and use those to build and to contribute to the position of the group.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of Boardroom Bound. My name is Alexander Lowry, and this is the podcast dedicated to intentional leadership in the boardroom. My goal is to give aspiring and existing directors the tips, tactics, and strategies necessary to transform your confidence and build a successful career as a board director. Quick reminder, you can get all of today's show notes at podcast.gordon.edu. And in today's episode, I'm speaking with Rich Horwath, and he leads the Strategic Thinking Institute. This is someone who is a former chief strategy officer and professor of strategy. 7 books, New York Times bestseller, Wall Street Journal bestseller. This is someone who knows a few things about strategy. And as board members, whether we are in the boardroom or want to be in the boardroom, we are all going to be focused upon that. That is how we're adding value. We are no longer executing. We're not in the C-suite where they're giving guidance and feedback and coaching and ideas. We all need to be better about strategy. Rich is the perfect person to help us think through our frameworks and our approaches. And he's got some great ideas, some easily actionable content that we can all take away. For example, his very simple framework for every board meeting you walk into, think about 3 A's, your acumen, your allocation, and your actions. And if the company can be focused on those, you'll have been successful in your role as a board member. I can't wait to share Rich's really interesting ideas with you today and talk about his latest book, which is unlike any strategy book you have ever seen. I promise you that. Let's jump into the show. Rich Horwath, welcome to the Boardroom Bound podcast.
Thanks, Alexander. Great to be with you today.
Well, I'm delighted to have you today to do a deep dive, and it sounds ironic. We're going to do a deep dive into strategy because for our audience, we all hear, whether you're an aspiring board member, new board member, seasoned board member, strategy is the most important thing. You have stopped being and doing from the C-suite, and now you're on the other side, noses in, fingers out. You need to give guidance and feedback, ask strategic questions, review the strategic plans. That sounds simple, but there's so much nuance to it, which I'm thrilled to just have an expert on it and to really do a deep dive into what that looks and feels like. You clearly coach lots of full boards and board members on these sorts of topics. So I think we'll run the gamut today of people who are just beginning to think about what the best practices are and others who can perhaps refine what they're doing today. But it's probably a big leap for someone who's listening to go, how do you be an expert on strategy? What does that look and feel like? You have clearly been there and done it all from, you know, being a professor of strategy, a former chief strategy officer. But help break that down for us. How did that career begin for you to get to where you are today?
Well, Alexander, it really started about 20 years ago, and I was working in a marketing firm writing strategic plans for companies, and at one of the breaks we were having a strategic planning offsite, and one of the members came up to me from the management team and said, I just had my performance review, and my boss said that I'm too tactical. I need to be more strategic. How do I do that? And so this was about 20 years ago, and most of the literature on strategy at the time was really focused on corporate strategy. You know, you had books like Michael Porter's Competitive Strategy and Competitive Advantage. So it was very much at the corporate level. And there wasn't really a roadmap for individual managers and leaders to be strategic. So that's really when the light bulb went off for me and said, you know, this is something that's important to people. And so that's really where my research began and my writing began. And that's really where I started to focus on how can we help people think strategically in order to guide their companies and to guide their boards.
And clearly it has evolved from there. And I imagine you were very early in this space in order to end up with a website like strategyskills.com. That must have gone pretty quick.
Yeah, you know, it certainly has. Over the last 20 years, it's been interesting. When I first started, you know, strategic thinking was out there a little bit, but it really wasn't defined. And so my goal was to really start to put some texture around what does it mean to think strategically. And, you know, the definition that I've landed on is really the ability of a manager or board member to generate new insights on a regular basis that helps an organization achieve their goals. And, you know, we hear the word insight thrown around a lot. And to me, the simplest definition of an insight is a learning that leads to new value. So when you're thinking strategically, you're actively learning each day, each meeting, each encounter with a customer or a colleague. You're constantly asking, what does this mean, and how can we translate this into value, either internally for the folks that we work with or externally for our partners and our customers.
And Rich, let's go back to that story you were telling a little bit before where someone was saying, I need to be less tactical and more strategic. Now, we're talking about insights and ideas. Clearly, you have those on both of those different levels. Help us understand the difference. I'm sure it's like a thin red line between strategy and tactics.
Yeah, Alexander, you hit it right on the head, too. I look at hundreds of business plans and strategic plans each year, and what you just mentioned is probably the number one area of challenge for folks is that difference between strategy and tactics. And sometimes people define the difference using time as a parameter. So strategy is long-term, tactics are short-term. However, I found that's not as useful because sometimes a strategy can be accomplished, you know, within a matter of months potentially, and sometimes it's a matter of years. So time is not necessarily the best indicator. However, what I like to do is think about both strategy and tactics as how. So strategy is how are you going to achieve your goals and objectives in general terms. Tactics are how you're going to achieve your goals and objectives in more specific terms. So if we think about strategy, it's abstract. It's like leadership or love. You know, you can't reach out and touch it. And tactics tend to be more tangible. So I use what I call the rule of touch, which means if you can reach out and physically touch some aspect of it, it's more likely to be a tactic. And again, we need to remember, and Alexander, you know this as well as anyone, that these concepts really started in the military arena thousands of years ago. Mm. And even that far back, Sun Tzu, the Chinese general and philosopher,
right,
who had the writings, which became the book, The Art of War, even that far back, he said, all the men can see the tactics I used to conquer, but what none can see is the strategy out of which great victory has evolved. So to your point, strategy is really that abstract, that general approach to getting to the goal. Tactics then are going to be the more specific, tangible ways that we're going to get to those goals and objectives.
I remember how that book became so popular when Tony Soprano on the character Soprano started reading it again, and Dr. Melfi, his psychologist, talking about it, and suddenly it had a resurgence. It's amazing the timeless insights from that book that still, you know, if your enemy is upset, provoke him, make him more upset. You know, it's brilliant sort of stuff. Some of it's a little aggressive, of course, because it's meant for the military, but to your point, the military academies, they just teach leadership. They teach strategy, teach execution. When I think about back to my business school, the best leaders, the best strategy guys had probably come out of West Point and Annapolis and those sorts of places because they've been steeped in it for years, which I think comes back to the point that sort of this show starts out, is that some of this is really an art and a science combination, and you can practice it, you can hone it, but of course there's more to it than that. I'm sure you would say part of it is also you need to have an openness and a willingness to listen, an ability to check your ego at the door to listen to others' insights, because you don't come up with strategy in a vacuum, right?
Yeah, it's a great point. And one of the things when I'm working with board members especially is we're constantly looking at, number one, do they have business acumen? So does everybody have a certain level of understanding of what strategy is and how to develop it, as we've talked a little bit about? And to your point just a moment ago, we also want to understand, is there a level of emotional intelligence? Meaning, am I aware of my own emotions and how I use those within a board interaction? And then also, how do I manage the relationships? And part of managing relationships successfully, as you just pointed out, Alexander, is really the ability to listen and not come in thinking I know all of the answers, but rather I'm going to ask great questions in order to generate conversation and insights from the rest of the group. And then I'm going to take those in and use those to build and to contribute to the position of the group. So I love what you said there, because I think sometimes when we talk about strategy, it becomes more about Excel spreadsheets and numbers and things like that. But there is that emotional component. And as you mentioned, listening is absolutely a key ingredient to being able to come up with those insights that will generate great strategy.
And I think back to my own boardroom discussions, and I find it in some ways exhilarating, but also incredibly hard to do strategy to board level. You're talking, let's say, 12, 16 people, depending on the type of board, sitting around the room, bright people, energetic people, thoughtful people who've come in with ideas, are listening, asking good questions. And in a sense, it's really hard to get everybody's input because you don't want to dominate the conversation. You can only add so many insights yourself, and you want to be listening to what others are saying and not thinking about it. It's almost hard for a group of that size to come up with a strategy. I think about, I'm on one of the largest YMCAs in the country, and we're making the strategy plans for the next 5 years. It's so much fun, and yet it's so hard. You need to give enough space for everybody out and to balance that. How do you help boards think about creating the right environment for this to be effective?
Yeah, it's something that you know, as you mentioned, it can be very challenging. And one of the things I like to do is start with pre-work. And so, you know, as you've experienced as well, I think the more that we can create a baseline of understanding coming before we even get together face to face, I think that's very valuable. And you know, typically pre-work would take the form of articles, books, book chapters, white papers, anything that would kind of set the tone and kind of prime the pump for people's thinking. So, you know, I like to share sometimes case studies and other things that will spur people's thinking so that when they come into the room, there's already a fairly good baseline understanding of what strategy is. And then to your point, I think one of the keys is between the senior leadership team and the board of directors, really understanding what are our expectations for this session, because to your point, there's a big difference between thinking strategically and generating new ideas and actually walking out with a plan or a concrete goals and strategies that the team has agreed upon. So sometimes we need to be careful and make sure that we manage expectations. So if we're going to be having more of an idea generation session and thinking strategically, we need to make sure that everybody is aware of that, so that we're not necessarily, you know, people aren't necessarily thinking, well, we've got to come out with the strategy. And in the same token, you know, there's a time to really coalesce and bring together everyone's ideas and insights and channel those into that plan that we're going to live by. So I think, you know, there's two clear things for me initially is, number one, let's do some pre-work to get everyone that baseline level of understanding. And number two, let's manage expectations coming into the session and then design the session to achieve the expectations that we've set out. And, you know, as you mentioned, when you've got 13, 16 people in the room, it can be challenging. What I typically like to do is provide visual exercises for people to go through. So using flip charts and whiteboards, so that we're putting things up for people to react to respond to. And then typically, to your point, if it's more than 13, 14 people, breaking folks into two or three small groups can generate a lot of ideas as well, and then you bring them back together. So those are some of the best practices that I've seen as far as board work goes.
And I like those. And I also am a big fan of the parking lot idea, because brainstorming is great because everything can go up on the board, but sometimes it can easily take you down a rabbit hole and go off into a tangent. So let's capture these great thoughts. Some of it may not be as relevant for today. We might get to another time. We'll put it in the parking lot. We don't want to forget them because they've come up. How do you handle that when in some ways you might be, what I liken the process to is a diamond shape. So I'll use the baseball analogy. The first you start with the opening of the diamond. You're going from third base towards second at home, and you're putting all of those ideas out there. And that's sort of the beginning session. Let's get a lot of stuff out there. And eventually you're going to close it back down as you get towards first base. You're funneling back to what you want to do. It's fun. It's exciting, but it can also be really hard work. I imagine many times you've been facilitating these conversation riches. What are your strategies to help people understand as you switch from the two different modes?
Yeah, Alexander, it's an important aspect of facilitation. And for those listeners out there that are facilitating board sessions and leading those, I think, you know, the first thing to do is to really think about, you know, the group in general. And I think sometimes we lean towards, you know, being inclusive and generating as many ideas as we can, and we absolutely want to do that. I love your idea of the parking lot, and sometimes I'll even have several parking lots. So one might be tactical parking lot, because to your point, if we're talking about strategy, and you mentioned it earlier, sometimes people will jump into kind of those tactical rabbit holes where they start really talking about execution, you know, even things like colors or sizes of products, and we don't want to get there. So to your point, and I like your idea of the parking lot, you know, you can put up a tactical parking lot and say, hey, that's a great idea. Let's put that in the tactical parking lot, and we'll get to that as we move down the road a little bit later. So I think as a facilitator, you have to have the courage to keep the entire group on point. And again, I think you want to have a certain level of outline for the session, but then to your point, you don't want to be so prescriptive that you're not allowing really robust, dynamic conversation to go on. And so one of the things to your point that I like to do is when I have my agenda, I actually don't break down the time frames by topic. I'll have one section at the top of the agenda with topics. So here are the 3 to 5 things we're going to cover in this session. And then I'll have a very general time frame, 8 to 10 o'clock, lunch at 12 to 1, and then in the afternoon, one small break, just so people have general times. But as a facilitator, for those of you out there doing it, we don't want to be too locked into the time frames because we want to be open to the good ideas that are coming out.
And I remember the way I think about it is you're never quite sure how it's exactly going to go. I remember there was a CEO of a company when I was in my management consultant days we were leading a strategy session for, and we had agreed with him that we would take a lot of his top lieutenants from across the business for the whole morning and do this strategy session. And I popped out during lunch and I said, I'm going to need these guys for the rest of the day. He said, no, they need to get back to business. I said, you're going to really be happy with the results. They had so much great ideas coming out of this because they hadn't done this in years that we ended up with having more ideas about different things than we'd ever thought of before. So how do you, Rich, help organizations understand the timing and the frequency that they should be doing things like this? Is it an annual basis?
Yeah, so, part of it's, I've learned through just research and research from, other organizations out there. And some of the research shows that when you look at the number one driver of revenue growth in for-profit companies, it's the reallocation of resources throughout the year from underperforming areas or initiatives to ones with greater performance. And so, that's something that's really stuck with me. And so I use the analogy of a car. Typically we're not going to take our car in once a year or once every 18 months to get it looked at. And in the same token, so we're going to take a car in more often for a tune-up, whether we need to rotate the tires or change the filter or so forth. So I like to think of strategy almost from a tune-up perspective. And, again, from a board standpoint, typically boards have meetings set up, and what I like to do is, at least on a quarterly basis, have that strategy tune-up, even if it's only for an hour to 2 hours for that session. And in that strategy tune-up, then ensure that the group is covering 4 areas. And again, when you think about strategy, we often hear of it described as the big picture. Those 4 areas typically are the market. So what are the trends, the patterns that we're seeing in the marketplace in general? Secondly, then the customers. So how have customers' thinking and behaviors changed since the last time we've been together? And then the third area is the competition. So how is the competitive landscape shifting or shifted? Is it primarily traditional competitors? Are there some non-traditional competitors entering the space? And then finally, the company. So when we think about the company, the people, the processes, the systems, the infrastructure, the culture, what are some of the key things happening in those areas as well? So I like to think of those 4 areas, and I've actually developed a tool called the Contextual Radar, which is simply a circle, if you think of a radar screen with the 4 quadrants, and then those 4 areas labeled: market, customers, competitors, and companies. So just a very simple visual to get people thinking about what's happening in those areas. And that can really serve as a good tool for that strategy tune-up, again, typically on a quarterly basis, maybe 3 times a year.
And Rich, that makes a lot of sense. And I find it a bit ironic that most of us are pretty good about taking our cars in for maintenance, but not for our own selves and our health maintenance with the doctors. But maybe that's a different strategy conversation for another day. I would love to hear your thoughts of having worked with many boards on strategy and led them through the exercises. I think for many of our listeners who are either new board members or aspiring board members, there will be a transition period from when you were in management and you did this strategy stuff and you lived it all the time to when you're doing it at the board level. And you want to be involved enough, asking the right questions, but you don't want to overstep your bounds and become management. Clearly, management does the execution, but management often does a lot of the strategy and brings much of that thinking to the board. How do you help organizations wrestle with the dichotomy between these?
That's a great insight, Alexander. I think I've seen that quite often as well, where you have some very seasoned, experienced senior leaders that have moved into board positions. And like you said, there is a line of distinction between being on the board and being a senior leader of the organization. So one of the things I try to to inform board members of, especially new board members, is that, you know, your role is really more of counsel at this point. It's more advisory in nature. It's not as management, dictatorial as it might have been in the past, where you're really prescribing actions and initiatives and projects. So I think, you know, one of the things I like to share with folks is think about a counsel mindset. So if we think about a counselor, if we go to a counselor, let's say for, you know, for ourselves individually, the counselor is really there to listen to us and then to ask some probing questions and then to provide some general guidance and some general feedback on what we're thinking. And so I think if a board member goes in with a counselor type of mindset, then immediately it puts him or her in that situation where, yes, I'm here, but I'm not just here to talk. I'm here to listen. I'm here to understand. And I'm here then really to provide some guidance and some input based on my experience as a leader. So I think you bring up a great point. There is that line of distinction. And again, I think that counselor mindset is one thing I've seen be helpful for folks in that situation.
And Rich, that's a great way for people to understand maybe how they should go about doing the work. But I'm also imagining a board member, and there are so many different types of people. Let's say they're going to get on their first board role, and they might have gotten on the board because maybe they were a deep industry expert. They bring a wealth of connections in a certain space. Maybe they were a risk expert or cyber, whatever it might be. Maybe they don't have the strategy background that, you know, I would bring from 12 years doing that in the consulting world. For someone who has to get up to speed very quickly, what are the best ways you do that? And the answer could be one of your books.
Right. Well, you know, the first thing I would say is, you know, when you're working with an organization, to me, the number one thing you have to understand initially is what is that organization's business model? And the business model is appropriate for both nonprofit and for-profit companies. And again, Alexander, I like to keep things very simple. There's a lot of literature out there about business models, but to me, a business model is simply three things. It's how do you as an organization create value, how do you deliver value, and then how do you capture value? So as a new board member, one of the things I would do is I would find time to sit down individually or on a phone call with one of the senior leaders, and I would ask her or him, tell me a little bit about your business model. How do you create value? How do you deliver value? How do you capture value? And again, it sounds like a simple question, but it can give you a treasure trove of ideas and insights and understanding about how the organization really works. So again, we often think about business models just in the context of a startup company. So what's their business model? They're trying to get, you know, funding to start up. But a business model is really appropriate for organizations in any stage of maturity. And really what the research shows is that one of the most effective ways to innovate within a company is not just product innovation or service innovation, but it's business model innovation. So really understanding how do we create value, deliver, and capture. And there may be different ways to let's say, deliver value or capture value. And again, when we think about some of the business models that have emerged in the last 5 to 7 years, you know, when you think about companies like Airbnb and Uber, you know, really what they've changed is the ability to deliver value through automation, through convenience, and through easier selection. So again, I would, as a new board member, I'd really ask about, probe about, and do some research on what is the business model? How does that organization create, deliver, and capture value? And that will give you some insights into how you might then lend some expertise from your past experience into those three phases.
I think that's a wonderful summary. And maybe the easy takeaway, maybe this is the tweetable for everybody, is that we all have to be strategic in the boardroom, because in today's ultra-competitive market, you either be strategic or you be gone, right?
Exactly. Exactly. And, you know, to your point, one of the things I've tried to do in the last book that I wrote, Strategy Man versus the Anti-Strategy Squad, which is basically a strategy textbook combined with a comic book, a superhero comic book, is to simplify concepts like the business model, competitive advantage, innovation. And so through using characters and stories, try to share some examples reality is there is no guarantees anymore. You have to be able to create that differentiated value. And that's really the heart and essence of strategy today is what's that differentiated or unique value that your organization can bring. So as a board member, that's one of the questions I want to know immediately from the senior leadership team is how would you describe that differentiated value that you bring to the marketplace? Because if a senior leader can do that, that means there's a foundation for good strategy there. If they can't, then to me, that's a red flag and that needs, you know, additional probing.
And I will say that I've got this copy of the book in front of me, and it is unlike any strategy book I have ever seen. And in the days of graphic novels becoming more popular, and think about The Walking Dead, such a successful series, I think this really will jump off the page for people, and they will find it a very different type of read, probably a lot more fun and engaging than perhaps what some people think about strategy books. So I imagine, Rich, this was probably harder to write than your other ones because it was such a different approach.
Yeah, Alexander, exactly. And, you know, it's funny because I challenge the companies that I work with all the time on, you know, how are you doing things differently? How are you innovating? And, you know, I had written 6 books on strategy prior to this one. And so I turned that question to myself and said, you know, what are you doing differently? How are you innovating? And, you know, I had seen, this was 10 years ago, I'd seen the movie The Dark Knight from the Batman series. And that was the performance with Heath Ledger as the Joker, where he won Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor. And, you know, walking out of there, I said, wow, that was a powerful performance. And so one of the exercises I do with companies is domain jumping, where we take ideas from one industry or area and bring them into another. And so I do that occasionally for my business as well and said, you know, how could we take that comic book genre, which was becoming more popular, and how could we combine that with strategy? And so I did research on the top 20 challenges that managers face, things like bad meetings, silos, misaligned strategy, and then what I did was personify those into villains. So things like fire driller for fire drills, the meeting menace for bad meetings, and so created a story around that. But to your point, you know, definitely added the challenge of creating the story, trying to create the characters, the dialogue, but really probably the most enjoyable writing experience I've had over the last 20 years.
Well, hopefully it's the kind of book you can easily give to kids and say, learn some strategy, Johnny. You'll enjoy this book.
And, that's exactly right.
And Rich, you're clearly doing something right between a Wall Street Journal and New York Times bestselling author and strategic thinking. It's clear that you've got a lot of knowledge to share, and we're thrilled that you're able to come on the show today and put us in the driver's seat about how we can go forward and be better about being in the boardroom, being strategic. And I wonder if you have any parting advice, perhaps someone who's coming into their first board role or preparing for that first board role, how can they be the best strategic thinker that they can be? What's the number one thing you would say?
Yeah, the number one thing I would say is have a framework to think strategically. Don't treat strategy like a birthday where it happens once a year, you get together, there's a lot of signage and fanfare, and then it goes away for 11 and a half months. And what I found, Alexander, is the most powerful, effective framework that I've seen is 3 A's. And again, very simple in nature. Acumen. So as a new board member, the first A is acumen. What's the insight? What's the new learning? What's the new value that this company is providing? That's the first question. The second one, the second A is allocation then. How is this organization allocating their resources, their time, their people, their budget to achieve the goals that they've set out? Are they focused or are they trying to be all things to all people? And then that third A is action. How is this organization focusing, prioritizing, so that they're doing the things that are going to drive their success? Are they able to execute the strategy through their people, their culture, their processes? So if new board members can remember those 3 A's, acumen, allocation, action, each meeting, that will give them a nice framework to trigger questions and insights that they can share with the leaders they're working with.
Well, Rich, that is easy to remember and lots of fun. And the reality for all of us is there's only enough time in the day to do everything that matters, which means you have to have figured out what matters and be able to prioritize it. So I think this is a great framework that we can all follow. And we so appreciate you being on the show today and helping all of us to be more boardroom bound. We will have links to your best-selling books that people can pick up, and especially the coolest comic book strategy book that I've ever seen. So, Rich, thank you for joining all of us today and helping all of us to be boardroom bound.
thank you, Alexander. I've really enjoyed your podcast and your sharing of your knowledge with all of us as well. So thank you for the opportunity.
That's it for this episode of Boardroom Bound. I really enjoyed chatting with Rich Horwath. It's great to hear someone who is a bestseller on New York Times list, Wall Street Journalist, prolific author, 7 different books, leads a Strategic Thinking Institute, professor of strategy, former chief strategy officer. This is someone with the right credentials who actually coaches boards and helps them work through these processes today for help each of us to think about how we better represent ourselves and add the strategic value into the boardroom. Now remember, if you head over to podcast.gordon.edu, you'll get links to all of the resources that we talked about today. And please know that the Boardroom Bound team and I are so proud to be your go-to podcast for all things that connect, prepare, and empower you to land a board seat. Be sure to subscribe to this podcast so you don't miss any of the high-quality content that we're bringing to you every Wednesday. Thanks for joining me today. I can't wait to share more stories and strategies from brilliant business minds with you again next week. Remember to keep tuning in to be boardroom bound.